Hello and welcome to Stern Effects. In this video, I'll show you how to optimize an After Effects project with the help of the composition profiler, as well as speed up renders using the work area and region of interest. Now, we all know that render time can vary a lot. Sometimes it can be hard to pinpoint exactly why some projects render faster than others. The After Effects developers at Adobe use the phrase "all the pixels, all the time" to refer to the underlying philosophy behind the way that After Effects renders. While there are several ways to interpret exactly what this means, one of the ways to think about it is that all the pixels in a layer are processed even if they are not visible. But how can we tell which layer or effect is the cause of this render hog? And what can we do to make it better and quicker? Well, just stick right here to find out. First, we need a project to work with. And if you want, you can use the same project that I'll be using because it is a free motion graphics template that you can download from Adobe Stock. I'll put the link in the description, and if you wish, you can license it yourself and then use After Effects to open it, optimize it, and then export it again so it will be more responsive in Premiere Pro. So let me show you how this works. I'll hide my browser. I have After Effects open with nothing inside. And then I'm going to go to the File menu and choose Open Project. I've already downloaded this MOGRT file, Motion Graphics Template, and saved it over here on my desktop. So I will select the file and choose Open. After Effects is going to extract it into a folder, and you can name it whatever you want. I'm just going to leave the same name. I'll choose Extract over here. And after a few moments, the project is going to be opened, and I will get this warning that this was created with an earlier version and I need to convert it. The original file is not going to be changed. All right, I'll click OK. I'm also going to switch back to my workspace. I'll close all of these over here, as well as this composition and this composition, and just go to the beginning. I'm also going to tidy up this timeline. Let's just scan all the layers to see that everything is okay. There are no missing files here. And if I'll start to scrub it, I can see how this works. And I can also see that probably after this point, there is nothing interesting over here. So the first thing to do is to probably trim the project. And for that, I'm going to use the work area. The work area is this length, which is determined by this bar over here. And this is a section that you want to focus on, preview, or maybe even rendered out. So we can use this part on the right to set the end of it, or we can go to where we want to end, over here, let's say, and press the letter N to set the work area end. We can do the same thing for the beginning. Let's say that we want to start over here. We can place our current time indicator. And then instead of dragging this work area start, we can use the letter B for the beginning of the work area. Now, there are even easier way to work. Let's say that you want to select a couple of layers. So for example, I'm just going to go over here and select this layer and trim it by pressing the Option and closing bracket. So now I have two layers, or maybe a few of them that I want to select. I'm just going to command select both of them. And you can set the work area for selected layers by pressing the command option B. This will be Alt Control B on the Windows side. All right, so now that we know all of this, I'm just going to undo a few steps. And because I already set the working area for the place that I need to worry about, I'm going to right click on it and ask After Effects to trim the comp to the work area. And now let's just fit our viewer and press spacebar to preview the template. So while I was working on it, After Effects in the background cached all the frames, meaning that obviously we can just scrub the timeline or just play it the same way I just showed you, but we have a green bar. Although when we are working with this template or bringing it into Premiere Pro, things are not going to be so fast. And to help us scrutinize this composition, we're going to use the services of Oscar the Snail, which is this guy over here at the footer of the composition. Oscar will show us the information about the current frame render time, And if I'll click on him, he will expand a timeline column called render time. Here you can see a breakdown of each layer, all of its masks, layer styles, and even individual effects. So if I'll open up this adjustment layer over here, as well as its effects, we can see which one of these effects takes the most time to render. Now it's important to mention that there is no performance hit having the render time column visible, so you can feel free to work with it displayed. Notice that some layers won't show up in the render column. For example, layers which are not visible or switched off, or invisible objects such as nulls, cameras, and lights. However, in the render time column over here, you'll get a color-coded display of how much time each layer that rendered took to render and a bar graph of how that compares to other layers on the same frame. So the color coding system works like this. Render times that are either real-time or half real-time are displayed as shades of green with higher values from 100 milliseconds to 5 seconds displayed as increasing intensity from yellow to red. So let's use this information to try to make this comp more efficient. To do it, I'll close this adjustment layer for now, and I'll go over here to the end of this composition, and then I'll purge the cache. You can do it by going to the Edit menu and then choose Purge All Memory and Disk Cache if you're using disk cache, or just All Memory. This is what I'll do because there is a keyboard shortcut over here. So I'll make sure that After Effects is going to re-render this frame, and I'm just going to memorize the frame render time over here, which is just above 1 second. And we can also see it's a little bit of an amber color, meaning it's not real time. Okay, I can immediately see that we have few track mats, which are actually pointing to the same layer. So if I'll increase the width of the track mat column, we can see that everything over here is pointing to the same glitch mat layer. And I presume this is the same because I see that the name of the comp is similar. So I'm just going to double click on this and take a look inside. Let's just zoom all the way to the beginning. Yes, I think that this is the mat that everything here is using to creating this glitch title transition. Now, in the recent versions of After Effects, we can be more efficient. So what we can do is select all those layers, and I'm going to select the layers that are using this mat, this track mat, so all of these, and I'm going to use the same layer as a single source by using the track mat pick whip and select, let's say, layer number 4 in this case. This means that I can now select all the other copies and just trash them. And this is going to reduce the amount of time After Effects is going to need to think about this. And you can already see that we are down to 118 milliseconds just by modifying this little thing. We can also further investigate how this track mat is being used. And as you can see, it's only being affecting the titles over here. So this means that this layer is probably too big for what it needs to do. If we are only using just, let's say, this portion of the image, we may as well use the region of interest to just select the part that we are going to use. So something along those lines should be enough to affect the titles in the main comp. And then we can go to the composition menu and choose to crop this comp to the region of interest. And this is going to reduce the size of this composition, meaning it should speed up the preview as well as the render time of this main composition, and the appearance should look more or less the same. There are a few things that we can also improve if we want to maybe change a little bit the appearance over here. So again, I'm going to go to the last frame where everything is settled down, and then I'll take a look at the effect controls because I can see that this is one of the biggest render hogs here. this adjustment layer with all of its effects. So curves is very fast, unsharp mask and CC lens, those are not render demanding effects, but the camera lens blur is. And if you want, and this is totally up to you, you can actually try an alternative effect. So I'm going to go to the effect menu and under blur and sharpen, I'm going to try the compound blur effect, which is not going to look as beautiful as the camera lens blur, but it is much faster to render. So I see the value here is 5 and I'm using this layer, which is layer number 2, the blur ramp, as a blur map. So first I'll choose these. I'm going to switch off the FX over here. And usually I'm going to cut down the numbers by half. So 2.5 for the maximum blur. Now, it's not, again, going to yield the same result. Actually, I think that I also need to invert the blur since this is inverted over here. And let's take a snapshot. So this is the compound blur, which is much faster. You can tell by the render time column over here. I'm going to grab a snapshot and I'm going to switch it off, turn on the camera lens blur, which takes much longer time to render, and I'll compare between those two. Now, again, this is up to you. It's not going to yield the same results. The camera lens blur is much more fancier and beautiful, but if you can live with this effect, with this kind of blur, then you can save some time. And as long as we are seeing green values here, we are actually rendering things in almost real time. At this point, you can bring the essential graphics panel on screen, and you can re-export this motion graphics template and use it inside Premiere Pro. And I promise you, it will be much more faster and snappier. Now, there are a few things to take under account when you are using the Composition Profiler. Enabling Draft 3D, if you have 3D layers, is going to disable the Composition Profiler. And if the composition window is hidden or closed, the Composition Profiler will go dormant. Now, if you want to learn more and dive deeper into all the technical geeky stuff about this feature, I've included a link in the description to a PDF that Adobe created that explains how this feature is working in almost every scenario. But this is it. I'm going to go to the beginning and play for you the final thing and summarize. Few important tools to help you analyze the composition and make it faster, snappier, and more efficient. If this information was useful, please like this video and subscribe. Thank you. Also, stay tuned for more tutorials and check out the other content in this channel.